Hello ladies and gentlemen, this is Pangolin Advisor, here with a short tutorial video for the Behemoths. Behemoths are a new class of ship added to the Endless Space 2 Supremacy expansion, and you can see a Behemoth right here in the background of this main menu. Behemoths are independent of your faction, by which I mean that regardless of the main faction you choose to play, be that the newly added Hisho or anything else, Behemoths will always be an option for you, just as well they will be an option for your enemies. These mighty powerful ships serve several different purposes, they can range from either boosting your economy, helping you mine key strategic resources or luxury resources, and of course, the most fun of all, they help you destroy your enemies in a very spectacular way. Moreover, a behemoth can also be further specialized into machines of war that are even more efficient at destroying everything that stands in their path. The first thing you need to be aware of if you are planning on using the mighty power of the behemoth is that unless you start as the Hisho faction, who have the opportunity to begin their game with such behemoth, you will have to wait until you get a chance to actually unleash these mighty beasts onto the universe. First of all, you have to wait until the game starts the Worlds in Private quest. This is a cooperative quest given to every single player in your game. It requires all of the players in the galaxy combined to unlock several technologies in the military quadrant, and the amount differs depending on your game speed settings. Once you complete the quest, everybody will also gain access to Behemoth Technologies, and if you do well enough in the quest, you will also be given extra rewards depending on your particular game. Once you do all of this, you will have access to several technologies that will let you use the Behemoths, but the first and most important technology of all is right over here. It's called Behemoth Blueprints, and it allows you to actually start making Behemoths. You need to research this technology in order to make use of any other technology that includes Behemoths. As soon as you unlock the Behemoth tech, you will be given 3 different Behemoth chassis, or rather designs, because the chassis is actually only a single one. Well, it comes in 2 varieties, but it is still primarily the same chassis. So the 3 designs you are given at the start is an economic Behemoth, a scientific Behemoth, and a military Behemoth. Now, honestly, I'm not too keen on the military Behemoths, but I'll explain to you why in a second. Behemoths can serve a multitude of functions, so in order to showcase that to you, I'm going to create a new Behemoth chassis and redesign it from scratch. So as you can see, Behemoth has several different modules, and you can equip those modules with things that, for instance, will allow you to mine different planets for either FTSE, if your faction allows you to do that, or strategic resources and luxury resources. You can also use Behemoths to help boost the production of your home system or any other system you control. And finally, you can also park them at special nodes in order to give yourself more science and later on in the game more strategic resources as well. There are many other functions of a behemoth. They can, for instance, stop an enemy fleet from retreating from combat, which is my personal favorite. They can also terraform destroyed planets into habitable ones. So the functions are many and they are essential for a swift and efficient victory. However, unlike their cousins, the military behemoths are a little bit different. They replace some of their main modules with modules that you can install weapons on. However, while these behemoths are formidable in combat, they have less spots for specialistic modules that, for instance, let you mine planets for resources. Moreover, I do prefer having several smaller ships than having one big behemoth leading your fleet, because this behemoth cannot be embedded inside with any kind of fleet. They can only be standalone ships, not supported by your smaller ships. This means that when it engages in combat, it's going to take a lot of damage, and it is going to be extremely costly to repair a behemoth. Whereas if you use a regular fleet, you just take damage to 1 or 2 of your, let's say, 10 ships. You can simply exchange those ships for newer ones, or repair those ships for less of a price than if you were to repair a military behemoth. So, if you're looking for something that's really good at destroying fleets, Behemoth is a tempting choice, but it's not your ideal one. And I'll show you what is a far better ship at destroying entire fleets by talking a little bit about certain different upgrades that you can apply to a behemoth. The most important feature of behemoth types of ships is that they can be upgraded further into specialized chassis that are only based on the original behemoth model. So in order to do that, first you need to unlock the appropriate technologies. The easiest one to unlock is the third era of the Empire development quadrant, and it's right over here. It's called Citadel Blueprints. Citadel is one of the three specializations for the behemoth type of ships. And the other two can be found in the military quadrant, but only in Era 4. The first one is the Juggernaut Blueprints, and the second one is called Obliterator Blueprints. Together, they allow your behemoth to become less of a utilitarian type of ship and more of a ship that is clearly meant for militaristic actions. Although one of them is defensive and the other two are offensive. Let us begin by talking about my personal favorite, the Juggernaut. Juggernauts are ships of unparalleled power that can destroy enemy fleets with absolute ease, even on their own, but perhaps the most critical and crucial feature of a Juggernaut is that it cannot be added into a regular fleet, unlike other behemoths. If I can just find one of my fleets right over here, as you can clearly see, it has several different types of ships, including a carrier, some smaller ships, and also a Juggernaut alongside with them. This Juggernaut is in such a way more powerful than a single military behemoth could be, because it is now protected by my smaller ships and it is supplying the rest of my fleet with its incredible firepower. Moreover, a Juggernaut is not only a weapons platform that you can use to install a lot of very powerful guns on. It can still have a few specialistic modules, for instance one that makes it impossible for your enemies to escape from battle. And additionally, a Juggernaut can be upgraded even further to either give it even more battle modules, as I'm about to show you, if you go for the Juggernaut module upgrade, or alternatively, if you just want to destroy the enemy fleets without even fighting them, you can opt to go for Juggernaut battle upgrade, which unlocks the Iron Wave ability. The Iron Wave ability allows you to destroy all of the enemy forces without firing a single shot. All you have to do is unlock the ability, have a Juggernaut at the ready, and then all that is left for you to do is to activate the Iron Wave ability. Although you can only do that when there are enemy fleets on the system. Keep in mind, however, this ability will not damage your own fleet, but only the fleet that has the Juggernaut in it. If I were to use this ability on the system, it would destroy my other fleets as well as the enemy fleets. It's a very powerful ability with long cooldown, but it can help you win fights against hordes of enemies. Now, this is the Juggernaut. Next up is the Obliterator, perhaps the most fun addition to the Supremacy expansion, or rather Endless Space 2, that you can find in the Supremacy expansion. The Obliterator is essentially a Death Star for those of you who are big fans of Star Wars, or just a weapon of mass destruction. It can only have two modules and is very defenseless on its own despite its humongously large health pool. However, it has one extremely powerful function, and that is the fact that it can actually fire a missile that can obliterate an entire system. And I'm not kidding when I say obliterate an entire system, that's why it is called an obliterator. I already fired several such shots in this game, and as you can see, Bunny is one of the systems that was affected by an obliterator shot. It used to be a stronghold for enemy Volter faction, but I fired it upon it with an obliterator, and all that is left is several destroyed planets and a dying star. The obliterator is extremely powerful. The only limitations of an obliterator is the long time it takes for its shots to travel to their destination, which can be represented if you look closely at the shots themselves. Moreover, the shots are so massive you can see them even when you zoom out to the maximum level of zoom in the game. They are scary ones. They can destroy every system with the exceptions of systems that have no stars in it. The obliterator can only target a star. If a system has no star, like this system Lors in here, then the system is impervious to obliterator fire because it cannot be targeted. Finally, obliterators may sound scary, you know, and they certainly are, but they take a very long time to fire. It takes several turns for an obliterator to reload, and whenever you do want to fire one of its shots, you have to spend a considerable amount of quadrinics and or calcics on a single shot. However, the cost of an obliterator fire it changes depending on how long your obliterator had to reload, and as you can see over here, this obliterator would cost me only 24 quadrinics and arcacics to fire, whereas a different obliterator would cost significantly more because they just recently fired, as opposed to this one, which I could use to fire and instantly destroy another system. Well, not instantly, it would take me one turn, as you can clearly see. Regardless, these things are terrifying, and there are only two ways in the game to protect yourselves against them. One of these ways is by creating a citadel. The citadel is the third and the final specialization of a behemoth. If I click on a behemoth, you can see the three options right here, and the citadel is the final one. Unlike the other counterparts, a citadel is not a ship. It's a system-wide improvement to the stationary, and it can never be changed or modified, although there are certain system improvements that can make a citadel more potent. The citadel's most important feature is the fact that it can also block an obliterator shot on a system where a citadel is deployed. For this very reason, citadels are perhaps the best deployed on your key systems and your home systems as well, and they will protect them from enemy fire. Now, moreover, if you want to be even more secure, or you want to secure some other of your systems, there is another technology that you can also employ, and it's called a system shield. It's unlocked in the 4th quadrant of Empire development, and it's under Citadel Basic Upgrade. You do not need to have a citadel in order to install a system shield, as I can demonstrate right now. I can queue it up in a system that doesn't have any citadels on it, and it allows your system to reduce the amount of damage it would take from an obliterator shot by half. An obliterator is still going to destroy half of your population and improvements, but it's better to lose half of everything than literally everything, wouldn't you agree? Moreover, you can also obviously make those upgrades in tandem. Now, there is one reason as to why you wouldn't just put a citadel on every system, and that reason is the fact that behemoths are of limited quantity. You cannot have more behemoths in your empire than a set amount, and this amount can be increased depending on the faction that you play, certain unlocked technologies, and so forth. There are also certain heroes that can increase the amount of behemoths you can control at any given time. However, citadels also count against this limitation, and because of their limited abilities and inability to move, it's best not to have too many citadels and only employ them at the very most important systems that you have. So, with that, I hope that my guide has been enlightening for you. There's one final thing I want to say for all of you who are terrified of the obliterators. Whenever anyone in your game uses an obliterator, every single other empire in the game gets a notification that warns everyone that an obliterator shot has been fired. Nobody knows where the obliterator is fired except for its owner. However, if you have enough vision with your radar, you can see the obliterator shots on the minimap, like so, or like so when we zoom in. And then you can guess where they're going to land. And because the obliterator shots are relatively slow, it might give you enough time to shield your system. Or if you are a Vodiani player, you can simply unhook your mothership from a system and run away while you still can. Keep in mind, when an obliterator shot hits a system, it destroys everything on that system, including your own fleets. So make sure to move your fleets aside if you are about to open fire on a system. With that in mind, I would like to wish you good luck in your conquests. It was Pangolin Advisor, formerly known as Pan Chasso. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you online.